In this segment of Close Up, we're talking about Psycho, but it is not that famous shower scene, which is its own brilliant experiment, and we'll save that for another time. Instead, I want to talk all about film music. And yeah, I'm not talking about the soundtrack that we associate with sort of 80s pop cinema. I'm talking about what does musical composition bring to a sequence? Filmmakers are obsessively attuned to a score, what a musical piece can bring to a scene, to its rhythm, to its sensibility. And we have a history of brilliant composers who actually did some of their greatest work in film. Basically, I'm asking, why do filmmakers obsess over music score? And more specifically, what can a piece of music do to a film sequence? So I'm choosing one of my favorite pieces of music from Hitchcock's Psycho. I'm gonna do a scene that I think uses various motifs from that scene in fascinating ways and pretty experimental ways for 1960 in Hollywood cinema. To really get a sense of what the brilliant Bernard Herrmann is doing, you know, Herrmann worked with Hitchcock in so many fantastic films, Vertigo, Psycho we're listening to today. What Herrmann's doing is stunningly original if we contrast it with an equally compelling and beautiful example of film composition, but I suppose a composition that I'm going to call more conventional. The famous musical motif from The Lord of the Rings, Fellowship of the Ring. So the case I'm going to make is two great films, two compelling film scores, but used to such dramatically different ends, and they give us such a different sense of the way we're to feel about a sequence, about characters, and in fact about the entire sensibility of the film that we're watching. As you watch these scenes, I really want you to tune your ears. Don't worry too much about what you're seeing in terms of story or plot or characters, Norman and Mother, etc. I just want you to listen. So let's start with The Fellowship of the Ring. You don't have the visual behind it. That's deliberate. I just want you to listen to the music. Ask yourself, how does this music make me feel? I'm guessing you recognize this. Okay, listen to that note. That last note is so important to this composition. All right, that's Howard Shaw, who did one of the, I suppose, most recognizable, most loved soundtracks from The Lord of the Rings. And we associate it with The Lord of the Rings very powerfully. I'm going to play it one more time. And yeah, I want you to get a sense of how does the music itself give you a sense of, let's call it reassurance, a sense of stability, purpose. And I'm going to make a claim here that the way the music moves, the way that it moves through notes, and then you're going to notice it returns to that bass note. This is what is so brilliant in what Howard Shaw is doing. He wants to give you a sense of a journey of moving outward and returning. And of course, I'm going to argue you that this is going to really map what we're going to see with our Hobbit friends. So listen to it again. So there we see moving outward, and it doesn't matter how far it moves out, it knows it has to come back. And there we get that really glorious moment of resolution. Okay, in music theory, I'm going to call that the resolve of that piece of music. Everything is pulling me back to that point of centeredness and stability. And it's going to become a motif that is going to be used throughout The Lord of the Rings. You'll see it used with different instrumentation over different harmonies, but the bass line of let's go outward and let's come back is going to give The Lord of the Rings its dramatic core, but also its existential core. You know, this is what the movie's about. It's about a great journey. It's about destiny and finding your home. All right, let's go to something very different. Okay, if you know Psycho, Norman has been unveiled as Mother. How does Hitchcock choose to close this movie? Well, I'm going to suggest that the voiceover of Mother is quite eerie when you listen to this. But again, try to quiet down what Mother's saying. Just listen to the music and contrast it now with what Howard Shaw does in Lord of the Rings.
It's sad, when a mother has to speak the words that condemn her own son. But I couldn't allow them to believe that I would commit murder. They'll put him away now, as I should have, years ago. He was always bad. And in the end, he intended to tell them I killed those girls and that man. As if I could do anything except just sit and stare, like one of his stuffed birds. Well, they know I can't even move a finger, and I won't. I'll just sit here and be quiet, just in case they do suspect me.
What have we heard so far? A series of notes, a series of relationships between notes, which we can call intervals. But the point is where Howard Shore gives us that incredible sense of fulfillment and reassurance with a constant movement out and in back to that home of the piece. I hope you get a sense here that what Bernard Herrmann is actually doing is giving you a piece of music without what's called a tonal center. The music moves, but the relationships between the notes are so strange, so disconcerting, that as a spectator, it's really unclear to me, even listening, I've heard this so many times, but listening to this now, I'm so dramatically unsettled. I feel uncomfortable listening to it because what I'm listening to is something that has no center and has no place to resolve to. This is Bernard Herrmann's great contribution to really what is late classical Hollywood cinema, but one of the most experimental examples of film scoring in classical cinema. So what have we got here as a contrast? On the one hand, a beautiful score, but working with fairly conventional scales and notes in the way that Howard Shore puts together a musical journey for The Fellowship of the Ring. In Psycho, what are we looking at? In thematic narrative terms, the fragmentation of a subjectivity horribly, brutally decentered and overwhelmed now, to the point where we are really looking at a kind of psychotic episode. What does the music then do? It fragments, it breaks down. And the tonal center that we crave, and yeah, I'm speaking for most of us as listeners, when we watch a movie, we crave tonal centers to the music. Herrmann refuses to give that to us. So what does music bring to a scene? It not only gives us something that can complement story and character, but I'm going to argue here that Herrmann's stunning use of an atonal composition gives us, in fact, a way of experiencing the sequence as a whole. Without the music, the voiceover and that narrative plot point, the loss of Norman to Mother, is lost. With the music, we share that sense of being completely at odds with a sense of subjectivity, of character, of persona, and this becomes, therefore, one of the most disconcerting sequences, I think, in all of Hitchcock. Last point I'll make about this, film scores have always been far more present to spectators than we give them credit for. Film scores, I think, in the best examples, give me a cue for how to feel about a film. The influence of Herrmann in a moment like this is simply going to be staggering. And if you're like me and you absolutely love slasher cinema, horror cinema of the 1970s and 1980s, go back and look at some of those films and I guarantee you you'll have a sense of the presence of Herrmann underpinning the way the horror genre is going to try to unsettle spectators. Atonality, strange frequencies, strange rhythmic composition, all of it so beautifully coming together in a very simple sequence at the end of Psycho. I hope that gives you a sense of just what composers can bring to a scene that's so much more than just accompanying a visual image. Thanks for listening.